Welcome. Thanks, Frank. Thank you, Frank. That was a great introduction. The divider-in-chief, the fraud of hope and change. You get it? I mean, it's totally fraud. The notion that there was going to be this glorious hope and this glorious change. There's been plenty of change, of course. Just hasn't been quite so hopeful. So I'm thrilled to be here with all of you this morning. I get a little enthusiastic, so I'm sure we'll have to work on that volume thing. Okay, I know everybody has come here and said, I'm so glad to be here. It's so good to see you. I am really, really glad to be here. I'm not kidding you guys. This is like the highlight of my year. You guys inspire me, okay? And let me explain that to you. I give these talks and I go all over the country and talk to young people, but sometimes when I go, I'm like, what the heck am I doing? I'm exhausted. I'm tired of being picked on. Okay, so last night I was on the O'Reilly Factor, which I do once a week or once every couple of weeks. And let me tell you, that is a pain. You might think, oh, glamorous, lovely. I got this one text saying, or tweet saying, I usually don't communicate with celebrities. Okay, that is the funniest thing ever. I'm on O'Reilly once a week. Or, you know, I'm not a celebrity, and I was out mowing my lawn before I went and jumped in the car to drive to D.C., to ride to D.C., and there's nothing glamorous about it, but when I go, for one thing, I'm arguing more with Bill O'Reilly than I am with the liberal most of the time, and he's kind of mean sometimes. I mean, he can just, you know, hammer away at me. For one thing, I don't get to say what I really want to say. If this is on TV, we're in big trouble. So it drives me crazy, but then whatever I do and whatever I say, I get hammered. I mean, hammered on Twitter from both sides. Some people say, oh, you did such a great job, or your hair looks so good, or whatever it is. But I get pummeled, and it's from our side. You know, people saying, why don't you stand up for what you believe in? Why don't you fight back? Or why don't you calm down and stop interrupting people and stop being so aggressive and assertive the same night? I mean, it'll be, you're too assertive, you're too aggressive, you're not aggressive enough. And then the assaults from the left are unbelievable. And I make the mistake of reading them, and sometimes right before I try to go to sleep. So they are, last night it was, you dumb bee, you know, a lot of that. Every nasty word in the book, including, I get called the C word all the time. So this war on women thing that supposedly we're launching on them, that is a joke. I get it all right in the face from the left. And so after a while, it's like, why? Why am I doing this? You know, this is not fun. It's not fun to try to go to sleep with people calling you names. And by the way, that's all they've got on their side is calling us names. And then I come to talk to you guys. I remember this is what it's all about. I come and talk to you guys about the need to be courageous, to go into the battle, to go towards the smoke and the fire and the disaster like the Marines do. Sarah Palin says, they go toward it. That's what you and I have to be doing. And so for me to get down, because I've been called a couple names, is ridiculous. And it's, you guys have got to remember that too, because you're going to be called all sorts of names, particularly you lovely ladies, because you are a threat. You're a threat to the left far more than the guys, because they've got this lie going on out there that I bet Katie Pavlich talked to you about, the whole war on women nonsense. But if you all, you ladies, are out there championing conservative principles and you do it boldly and courageously, and you don't back down when they go after you. Destroy the myth. You are out there championing this supposedly sexist movement that actually champions women far more than the left ever could. We believe in independence and vibrancy for women, for ambition, for hope, to pursue our ultimate goals. They want us to be dependent on not a husband, not a tyrannical husband, which of course the feminist movement thought was so bad, these big bad men. No, they want us to be dependent on a much more tyrannical, I'm not saying you guys are tyrannical at all, but a much worse tyrant, and that is the government. Gosh, you can't get out from under that. And yet they are encouraging women with that stupid Life of Julia and all of their, and the never-ending welfare benefits, they are encouraging women to be completely dependent on the government. But you guys have heard a lot about that. You've heard about what's going on in the world, I'm sure, from all these great speakers. I hope you've learned a lot. I hope those of you who didn't know that much about conservative principles have just this, you're filled with facts and numbers and ideas. And what I'm hoping that after today, after listening to Kirby, after listening, I hope to me, you'll be filled with courage. That courage to go out there, regardless of what comes your way, and champion these great ideas that are the basis of what I firmly believe is the greatest country on the face of the earth. Now, I know not everybody believes it's the greatest country on the face of the earth. And sadly, our president is the number one guy who doesn't believe we're the greatest country on the face of the earth. And I'm not making that up. You guys have heard him say it a million times, you know, exceptionalism, all that stuff. We're no more exceptional than anybody else. It's a stunning, stunning thing for the president of the United States to think. Now, this is a guy who was literally brought up on the ideas of Saul Alinsky. I mean, get your head around that. The rules for radicals. That's what this guy, Barack Obama, when he became president, his only qualification, literally, his only qualification, the only thing he had excelled at was being a community organizer. He was a darn good community organizer. He was considered by his fellow community organizers to be one of the best. And they followed these rules for radicals. When Barack Obama and his fellow community organizers would go into a community, what would they do? Their directions from Saul Alinsky and the others was to rip people apart, divide them, make them hostile and angry towards a person or a business or an idea, but get them filled with angst and even hate. Get them not focused on the ideas and the rational reasons behind whatever it is that you want to do, if you have any rational reasons, but just get them so riled up. And that's exactly what we've seen this community organizer do at the national level to our country. I just saw the other day, you probably saw the poll that said Americans are more divided than ever. Really? I mean, it comes as a surprise to some people. Last night, Bill O'Reilly, one of the things I've gotten criticized about, he said, he was talking about the hater comment that Obama said, you know, why can't you all just stop hating, that he said the other day. I want you really to process. The President of the United States says to you and me, all of us, why don't y'all just stop hating? Okay, well, wait a minute. I don't hate. I don't even hate him. I don't like him, and I certainly don't like his ideas, and I do hate. I hate what he's doing to this country. So maybe that's hating. I don't know. But I hate seeing our country divided. And what I really despise, I don't even like the word hate. I won't let my kids say it. What I really despise is how he is shutting down debate, shutting down the free and open exchange of ideas. And y'all are seeing it on your campuses, too, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But by villainizing you and me, this administration, this president, let's just call it what it is, this president is trying to quash debate. If he can convince the public at large that conservatives hate women, want to take them back to the Stone Ages, want to take away their birth control, don't want them to have rights, don't want them to have equal pay, don't want them to have protection from violence against women, then it doesn't matter what our arguments are when it comes to issues related to women. We hate them, so it neutralizes us. We don't even have a voice at the table anymore if we hate women. That's what you saw happening in 2012, 2013, and boy, oh boy, that's what you're going to hear happening this go-around. If they can convince the public that we hate immigrants, they're not talking just about illegal, they're trying to say that we hate all immigrants. Well, we all came from immigrants, and yet we supposedly hate immigrants. We hate black people. We hate poor people. You know, this is the actual rhetoric that they're using, and I've got a few examples here, not just from the divider-in-chief, but over a period of time, and these are just a few examples, I wrote a whole book on it, and I'm not going to take you through the whole book, don't worry. Jay Rockefeller said just in May of this year, Opposition to Obamacare is because people made up their mind they don't like Obama because of his skin. Really? Okay, so if they convince people of that, it doesn't matter what our policy objections are to Obamacare bankrupting our country. If we're opposed to it simply because we're racist and people believe that, if they believe that, they're not going to listen to us. It doesn't matter. And, you know, you get that because if we have some sort of serious moral failing, well, you don't, if somebody, if you know somebody is a racist or a bigot, you really don't pay much attention to their opinion, right? That is exactly what they're trying to do with all of us. Neutralize us, demonize an entire half of the country. Joe Biden, remember when, I know, Joe Biden is like a punchline in and of itself. You don't even have to say anything. It's like, Joe Biden, so remember back in 2012 when he said that Republicans want to put black people back in chains? I mean, of course, the media just glossed right over that. No big deal, no big deal. We want to put black people back in chains. That is a stunning comment for the Vice President of the United States to make. Chuck Schumer said Republicans are extortionists and hostage takers. This was during the shutdown of the government debate. White House advisor Dan Pfeiffer said, we're not for negotiating with people who have a bomb strapped to their chests. So we're terrorists. You know, in addition to being haters, we're terrorists. Harry Reid says, the anarchists have taken over. They've taken over the House and now they've taken over the Senate. We're anarchists. Now, that's not a nice thing to be called. On women, the last mailing I got during the 2012 election was Romney and Ryan are, and in big red letters, shocking and dangerous when it comes to women's health. Not we have differences of opinion, they don't think that employers should have to pay for contraception or blah, blah, blah. It's we are shocking and dangerous. If you believe that, I wouldn't vote for a Republican or a conservative either if I believed they were shocking and dangerous. Oh, and my all-time favorite, Sheila Jackson Lee, who over the past couple of y'all have been here, so you probably haven't heard everything that she's been saying, but oh my gosh, that lady's, she's a piece of work. She said just the other day, we never talked about impeaching George Bush, and she was co-sponsor of a resolution to impeach George Bush. And she also said the other day, she said, this isn't a quote because I can't remember the quote, but it's time for Barack Obama to just do whatever he wants to do. You know, no limitations, have at it, buddy, do whatever he wants to do. Okay, so in furthering that whole war on women mantra, she said, I think the next act, and she's talking about of conservatives, will be dragging women out of patient rooms and into the streets and screaming over their bodies as they get dragged out of getting access to women's health care. That's what we're trying to do. Can you believe this congresswoman actually said that? And that people, the scary part, I don't know that anybody believes Sheila Jackson Lee, but people are believing the lies and the myths that they're hearing. Barack Obama himself, it started in 2008 when he said, when he was running for president, he said, we know what kind of campaign they're going to run. They're going to try to make you afraid of me. They're going to say, you know, he's young and inexperienced, and he's got a funny name, and did I mention he's black? You know, that just got glossed over, too, that people are not going to vote for him because he's black. He called conservatives hostage takers and enemies, members of the Flat Earth Society. In one speech, he said, Republicans want children with autism and Down syndrome to have to fend for themselves. That's what kind of haters we are. We want these precious little babies and children with diseases to have to fend for themselves. He said the same thing about senior citizens. We're not concerned about them getting enough food to eat. This is the divider in chief, tearing us apart, trying to demonize, playing on the goodness, the goodwill of people, because nobody likes to be called a hater, and nobody likes to listen to a hater. And so what do you and I do when we get called these names? We shut down. That's what the conservative movement often does. Even though it's so clear that Obama's policies are actually damaging the people most, who he claims to champion. Poverty-stricken Americans. Poverty is at one of the highest rates in half of a century. It is crazy. 46 million Americans are living in poverty. It's sort of this divide and conquer mantra. That's why during this election, you're hearing the White House talking about impeachment of their own president. Because they've got nothing else to run on, so they're trying. That's when he said, you know, y'all got to stop hating me so much. Trying to make it look like we're trying to impeach this president. Nobody's trying to impeach the president, except the Democrats keep talking about wanting to impeach the president. Oh, some people, yeah, I know, but they're not, you know, elected. Elected officials are not going around talking about actually impeaching the president. They're talking about a lawsuit. Now, I don't know if it's strategically the most brilliant thing when there's so much else for conservatives to be running on and to be talking about during this upcoming election season. I don't know that it's smart to have the distraction, but you know, if you take an oath to uphold the Constitution and your president is willfully trampling it, you know, with these ridiculous executive orders that far exceed his authority, what do you do? I mean, do you just sit back and say, well, it's not politically expedient for us to do anything? I think for once, Republicans in Congress are actually maybe taking a bit of a principled stand. They, you know, you can't win for losing. They're going to get hammered either way. But I think maybe they're actually standing up for something. You know, Thomas Sowell said, the Constitution cannot protect you if you don't protect the Constitution. And that's really something that we need to remember, because we think, oh, don't worry, we've got the Constitution, the greatest founding document on the face of the earth. We're good to go. But it's not if we just let people constantly trample it. Okay, so that's what this president is doing. But what I want to talk to you about is this division in our society and what's happening on campuses. And I think it's already happened on campuses before 2008, before this president started systematically dividing us and turning us against one another, making us hostile and suspicious of one another. It's happened on campus by things like these free speech zones. You know about, do y'all have free speech zones at your campus? Yeah. A stunning thing. I went to the University of Missouri a couple years ago to talk, and I was talking about these crazy free speech zones on campuses where you could say whatever you want if you stand inside the free speech zone and you step outside of it and you lose your constitutional right to say what you want on campus. Like, that's okay. And these kids who I was talking to were like, yeah, that's bad. That's, wait, we have one. We have one. They didn't even realize that they had one. It's like the frog in the boiling pot of water. They didn't even realize that their rights were systematically being taken away from them, because they're students, for one thing. They're used to being told what to do. And trust me, the leftists on campus take advantage of that. They take advantage of these young people's goodness and willingness to follow the rules. And so they say, hey, when you come to our campus, a lot of schools, they've got these speech codes. You may not say something that in any way offends somebody else. Unless, of course, it's one of you white guys or Christians or definitely Jews. You can say whatever you want to offend them. It's okay. But don't say anything to offend a persecuted class or a minority class. Don't say, oh, conservative women, sorry, you can be offended too. That you have no protection from this little free speech zone. But if you say something to offend one of these protected classes, you can be sent to sensitivity training. I mean, does it blow your mind when some football players are sent to sensitivity training? I mean, like, you can reprogram them? You know, we, in this country, you actually get to say offensive things. If you think them and you want to say them and you want to deal with the public scorn that comes, you get to say them. It's not a pleasant thing, and I wouldn't recommend it, but that's part of our country. And the reason is not so that we can have hateful thought out there. It's so that the difference of opinion can thrive, so it can clash, because that's how we were founded, not by, you know, these guys in the tri-corner hats sitting around singing Kumbaya. They fought. They said offensive things to one another. And yet, because of that, because they were free to say whatever they wanted to say within the bounds, I'm sure, of civility, which we don't have that much anymore, But they could say whatever they wanted to say, and because of that, we got the Declaration of Independence. We had these courageous warriors stand up and champion freedom, and we have our Constitution. But only because they got to say what they wanted to say. Now, it takes a lot of courage to say, you know what, these free speech zones are unconstitutional. Sensitivity training camps, that's unconstitutional. You can't do that to me. You can't tell me what I can and cannot say. You guys have got to stand up for that, because what's happening at the federal level, where they're telling us you can't say or think things, you can't say anything bad about illegal immigration because we're going to say you hate immigrants. You can't say anything about employers not having to provide contraception because we're going to say you hate women. And it's going to stick. And you know why it's sticking? Because our side is not fighting back. Because it's really hard. It really is. It stinks to go out there and be in the center of things and take all the hammering that comes when you've got the courage. Look at Ted Cruz standing up for what he believes in. And what happened? What happened to all of his fellow warriors? Well, I don't know him. I've never seen him before in my life. You know, he's standing up for why we sent all of these Tea Party folks to Washington, that is to rein in the federal government. So he actually took it seriously and said, I'm going to rein in the federal government or die trying. And I read this news report after there was a Senate Republican caucus meeting right at that time when, you know, Cruz was standing up for what he believes in. And, of course, John McCain, stalwart warrior that he is, just lambasted Ted Cruz. You know, everything you can think of. You are destroying everything. You're destroying us. You know, calling him all those names that we heard about in the press, you know, novice, but there were horrible things that they called him. Just belittling. And I thought, well, surely some of the conservatives in the Senate stood up and they said something and they had his back, just like we expect our fellow conservatives to have our back when we stand up and champion our values. You know what the report said coming out of that Senate caucus meeting? The other senators looked at their shoes. All of them, they looked at their shoes. That was the sort of courage. I mean, even on a closed door Senate caucus room, that's the level of courage that's coming from my generation right now. The Ted Cruzes, the Michelle Bachmans, the Sarah Palins, the guys on these walls, they are few and far between. That's why you have to become one of them. You all have to be the ones to stand up and champion all of the ideas that you've been learning about this week, the ones that you believe in, the ones that take fire, that take hold and light a fire in you. You have to stand up, and we can't keep on being scared. We have to take heart. You guys, read this book by Eric Metaxas called Seven Men. Well, read Bonhoeffer. I mean, it's like this big. But it's an awesome, awesome book. It is so inspiring. But Seven Men is just short little biographies of these seven incredibly courageous human beings. And Metaxas talks about to have courage is to have heart. To have heart, to have an abundance of heart that, you know what, you do what is right regardless of the consequences for yourself. It is not an easy thing to do. But he talks about these seven men who were willing to do it. And you know, one of these people who I hope y'all have heard a lot about this week, who had a ridiculous, vast reservoir of courage, and that is Ronald Reagan. And I don't know if anybody told you, they probably have heard this before, about the tear down this wall speech. You know, that moment that changed human history, changed the lives of millions of individuals, but also changed the course of human history. Of course, now, because we don't have the courage, we're seeing the course of human history turn back around. But Reagan, before he gave that speech, was told by everyone, do not say that line. Do not say, tear down this wall. The State Department redacted it. The Pentagon redacted it. His advisors took it out. And every time, Reagan wrote it back in. And when he stood there, he gets to say whatever he wants to say. And he said, Gorbachev, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. We think, oh, that was just a great statement. That was an incredibly courageous moment when the whole world was like, don't say that. don't say that. That might make them mad. Don't you hear that a lot now? We don't want to tick off our enemies. We don't want to embolden our enemies. Well, our enemies are pretty daggone emboldened right now. But Ronald Reagan went forward and he said, tear down that wall. He had an abundance of courage. And because of that courage, there was great and profound change. Also, our founders had that courage. And again, we think, no big deal. It was meant to be. Happened the way it was supposed to happen. We've got to sort of take ourselves back because our history teachers generally do not take us back. And we have to imagine what it was really like to be these guys. I mean, is this what they wanted to be doing? Just like that in 2010 when that Tea Party uprising, you know, don't let people trash the Tea Party, by the way. These are such good and decent human beings. A lot of them are retirees. Probably some of your parents, some of you. I loved when I listened. I never listened to Mark Levin because my blood pressure goes through the roof. But yesterday, I didn't realize he says, we are the Tea Party. I thought, yeah, man, you never hear that. People are like, oh, no, I have nothing to do with the Tea Party. Well, in 2010, this groundswell of people who never, ever imagined they'd be holding a sign up on a Saturday yelling something. It is totally out of most of their comfort zones. They're not paid activists. And you can tell that by the fact they don't leave any trash. Whenever they have their rallies, there's nothing. It's pristine. But it was completely out of their comfort zone. It was out of these founders' comfort zones. These men, you know, most of them were not firebrands or zealots. A lot of them were, we think of the really young guys who were the firebrands and zealots, who are my favorites, but a lot of these guys were middle-aged, very successful, wealthy. They had everything to lose. It wasn't like a lark. I got nothing to lose. I'm going to invest in this. We'll see what happens. They had everything. They had many children. They had everything to lose. And they went totally outside of their comfort zone in standing up for liberty and freedom, which they understood that liberty, this novel concept, which you and I take for granted, we all take for granted, and consequently it's slipping away from us. But they understood it was novel. It was actually a crazy notion that each one of us has complete freedom and that we parse away our freedom as we see fit to a government, only to keep order, only to maximize our freedom, not to take care of us, not to provide for us. But these founders understood that this was the most precious gift ever given to human beings. And it was worth standing up and worth fighting for, even if they fought to the death, which they knew when they signed the Declaration of Independence. There was no confusion about what that document was. It was their death warrant. When they affixed their names, they pretty much knew, unless some miracle occurred, they were going to die because of this. They were going to hang from a tree, probably. And yet they did it anyway. On August 2nd, when a lot of the signers signed the Declaration, William Ellery sat there and he watched. He was one of the signers and he watched and he said, in no face could I see discernible fear. And then Stephen Hopkins, who had palsy, which means you shake, when he signed the Declaration, he said, my hand shakes, but my heart does not. You know, they knew what was at stake. And many of these signers lost everything, absolutely everything. Francis Lewis from New York had vast estates. They were destroyed. His wife was captured and brutalized by the British. He eventually died because of it. He lost everything. John Hart, he was literally hunted down. He slept in caves. When he finally returned home, his wife was dead. His 13 children were gone, and he never saw them again. We don't hear these stories very often about the sacrifices that were made on behalf of you and me to have liberty. Or Richard Stockton, he was yanked from his bed, starved in prison, and died as a result of his mistreatment. Carter Braxton and Richard Henry Lee from Virginia, they were impoverished after the war. They died impoverished. And then Abraham Clark, he should be a household name. He had the courage to sign the Declaration of Independence. He's from New Jersey. And his two sons were captured, and they were tossed onto those horrific floating death camps, the Hell Ship Jersey, where everybody died. All the prisoners of war died. And Abraham Clark was asked by the British, was told by the British, if you will but recant, we will release your sons. Will you? And he said the hardest word of his life, no. And both of his sons died. I mean, is that a stunning moment where not just you do something and there's a consequence, but you do something, you're given the chance to change what you did so that your children might live, and you say, no. Not because I don't love my kids, but because I realize that we are standing for something bigger than ourselves, bigger than the two people I love more than anybody else on the face of the earth. Liberty, that gift from God above, is worth more than anything. If you and I can just believe in something bigger than ourselves, bigger than the hurt that comes from stupid tweets, nasty names being called us, or a professor giving us a hard time, or an administrator coming after us because of posters we put up during Women's History Month, or whatever courageous stand we take, you know they're coming after you. But if you can step outside of yourself and believe in something bigger, and boy, it's a hard thing to do. And I've been through so many humiliating lessons in my life that have taught me to believe in something bigger than myself and not to take myself quite so seriously. And a lot of you have heard those stories. But just not to care what people think about us. It's about our ideas and our vision. And I'm looking at you beautiful ladies in this group. And I know that sometimes, I know this not just because I'm putting stereotypes on you. I know it from experience, that sometimes it's harder for us to stand up and champion what we believe in. I don't know why. I just know it's true. So I encourage you ladies to get the training, you know, through YAF, through Claire Booth Luce, through leadership training programs in your state. There are tons of them out there. We have one here in Virginia that I started. Get the training that you need to be courageous leaders. Don't be in the background. We need you out in front. We need all of you, men and women, you young people, because Obama and his folks, they're preying on you. I mean, he's been on college campuses once every, something like 10 days. It's crazy. When he went to a campus in Arizona, he said that to pursue success in business, he was telling college students, you guys this, to pursue success in business shows a poverty of ambition. You greedy people. That's what he was trying to say. You all need to say, wait a minute. I think the businessmen and women of our country are some of the most courageous leaders in the world. Stand up for what you know to be good and true. We have sound objections to leftist policies on illegal immigration, on Obamacare, on government-mandated contraception. We have reasonable policies for wanting America to be the strongest, most influential nation on the face of the earth. We have absolutely sound reasons for opposing affirmative action and for opposing teachers' unions that have perpetuated dropout factories that have condemned a generation, mainly of black young people, to poverty. We stand up and champion those individuals and ideas that will bring about great personal prosperity and national prosperity and freedom, not just prosperity in a money sense, but in a soul sense, for who we are, and for all of our fellow man. We champion wanting every individual to fulfill the greatest possible potential, not live a life of dependency on a brutal, tyrannical government, but to be independent and free. That's what we want you all to leave this conference with, an understanding of the ideas and the importance of liberty, that ancient notion, but how important it is right now in our lives. And then to leave here with the courage no matter what the obstacles, to stand up and champion that freedom. Thank you guys so much. Thank you. Hi.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Welland, and I go to University of Notre Dame. And in now that's a, I mean, it's on the conservative side of liberal, if you ask me, based on my experience there. But I took this American Studies class, and I'm not sure if you're familiar with that field of study, but
well, it doesn't exist much anymore, so it's not. I'm not totally. But.
Well, I can see why, because basically in that class, all they did was belittle the American dream, talk about how American exceptionalism is wrong, and they also really criticized the founding fathers. They criticized their character, and they talked about how
bunch of white slaveholders.
Exactly. So they talked about how they're just hypocrites, so we shouldn't uphold their ideals, and they used that to kind of like basically disprove anything they tried to stand for. So when I'm in those kind of situations where professors and other students are talking about the founding fathers that way, mm-hmm. what can I say to them to help them realize that they're wrong and that the founding fathers are actually right?
Well, you talk about the ideas that they championed. Liberty for all individuals. And they say, what about the fact there were a bunch of slaveholders? They laid the foundation for unspeakable freedom that we have never known before on the face of the earth. Regardless of the circumstances and the situation, the time in which they lived, they championed great and abundant liberty. Dinesh D'Souza's movie America is fabulous on dealing with that myth that the founding fathers can just be written off because they were slave owners. So watch movies like America. But you know what? When your school destroys Western civilization, the roots of Western civilization, you need to go in there and demand a real class on Western civ, a real class on the true origins of America. And there are students who have done this. If you can't get that class, get a class in great conservative literature or the history of conservatism. I know the University of Virginia was able to push through that class. And there's always a waiting list. That class maxes out. Talk about, you know, find other examples of these classes at other schools and demand it. If you have a conservative newspaper, you should be writing about examples of how they trash the American founding. And you should send it to your alumni. For one thing, you'll get a lot of money off of it, but also you'll have influence. Because once the light shines on what they're doing, they're counting on y'all not telling anybody this, being really quiet about it. Write up a blog post and get Yaff to put it on the blog. They'll do it in a heartbeat. Expose, expose, expose. Don't let them treat you like you're idiots, which is what they're assuming and hoping. Y'all are just going to go along to get along. You've got to expose them. You've got to champion your ideas. You know what? When you raise your hand and you say something about Thomas Jefferson, you quote some awesome, awesome one line of Thomas Jefferson. You quote the Declaration of Independence. They're gonna trash you. Do it again the next day. Every day you come back with another one. For one thing, it's great training for you guys to be there in your classroom. Raising your hand the first time is a huge step. I know it is hard, but do it. And then do the best you can. You're never, ever gonna be fully prepared to take on your professors, your administrators, or your classmate who's a radical leftist. You're never going to be truly, perfectly ready. It doesn't matter. Go for it. Jump in there. I bet Baby Cannon told you that. Jump. Do it. Stand up for what you believe in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Hi, I'm Laura Beth from the University of Tennessee. First of all, thank you for coming to speak to us today.
Thank you.
You served as education advisor for George Allen. And as the daughter of two educators, how do you feel is the best way for young conservatives to champion states, just states' power and versus federal power of the education system and Common Core in general?
You just got to get involved in the movement. I mean, there's a huge movement right now that's fighting these national standards being imposed upon the states. You got to get involved in the national movement because that's pretty cool. But also get involved in your state. Because your local legislators need a lot of encouragement because the pressure from these teachers' unions is intense. They're bullies, and they like to have complete control. But do they really think that some nationally imposed curriculum is going to restore any sort of integrity to our classrooms. No, look for examples. There are so many examples out there on the web of the problems with Common Core, to put it mildly. So find those problems, write about them. But get involved with your state, local, and to some extent, the national movement. But you have a voice. I mean, don't think because you're 18 or 19 that you have to sit back and just learn. You can be completely engaged and be getting ready for when you graduate to run for office or to join a think tank or to stand up in some way and be a champion for what you believe in. So this is, again, it's great training ground for being a courageous leader.
Great. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'm Cole. I'm from Washington.
Hi, Cole.
So definitely the Tea Party in 2010 is largely responsible for Republicans retaking the House. So my question is, if people like the former governor of Alaska take a position of the government keep its hands off everything except for my Medicare and Social Security, then how can the Tea Party seriously call itself fiscally conservative if entitlement spending on Medicare and Social Security are taking up at the moment 45% of our federal budget, and according to numbers released by the Congressional Budget Office, if current rates of reimbursement of Medicare and et cetera continue, that basically everything except for defense spending, interest on the debt, and these entitlements for people who are disproportionately white and wealthy continue.
Yeah, I think that the Tea Party movement actually would agree with you on all of that. I think they would say that we need dramatic reform within all of the entitlements. However, that's not their focus right this minute. Their focus right this minute on what is coming at us right in the face. Not that entitlement spending isn't, because it's right there as part of the problem that is going to be the tsunami that's going to bankrupt us. But I've heard Sarah Palin talk about reform. Yeah, I have. Talk about reform.
What reforms?
Of entitlement. Various reforms of the entitlement program, so we need to look at some form of privatization. But right now, yeah, right. I know that needs, when we say that, they come back and say, you hate old people, you hate sick people, you don't want to provide for people who need help. And you're like, wait a minute, this is going to be bankrupt if we don't. We are the ones who are actually concerned about solvency and about helping those who we have made this compact with as a society. You don't just turn your back on that compact. For one, you change it for your generation. And you guys are the best ones to be out there talking about entitlement reform. You need to be out there saying, absolutely, for our generation, we want something to be left. We want there to be an abundance. And frankly, we think we can invest those resources better than the federal government. So let's look at creative ways of privatizing and reforming. But to do that, you got to get behind people who are out there championing these ideas right now. Because when people like Paul Ryan put these ideas out there, they run ads of pushing grandma off the cliff. And do you remember when they did that? Y'all might, I don't know if you remember it. They had grandma pushed over the cliff. They were on the verge of some entitlement reform. And what happened when grandma went off the cliff? Shut it down. One stupid ad that played on people's fears. Again, it's what's dividing us and tearing us apart. But we can't stop when that happens. We have to come back stronger, louder, and say, no, no way. You're not getting away with grandma going off the cliff. Y'all are the ones pushing grandma off the cliff. Let me explain to you how we're going to take care of grandma and provide so that young people will take care of themselves, because they don't want dependency on the federal government.
Ma'am, thank you so much for your time coming out today and supporting the YAF. I'm Rosie Lane. I'm going to be a freshman at the Bastion of Liberty Citadel of Conservatism Hillsdale College this fall.
There we go.
And my question for you today is really kind of a segue off the last speaker's question, which was, what does the future of the Tea Party look like going forward? A lot of times we see from the media saying that the Tea Party is kind of dead, or the Tea Party should immerse itself with the
establishment. They would love that.
I don't agree with that. I'm a passionate Tea Party person for liberty, but I want to know what your take is on that. Thanks.
Well, first of all, there's not a Tea Party. I mean, there are various Tea Party groups, but the Tea Party is kind of part of the conservative movement. They're part of the Republican Party. So I don't think they're going anywhere. I think that they will continue to have a role. I hope that, frankly, they have a bigger role within the Republican Party. I hope that they continue like they do in Virginia. They've taken over the governing body of the Republican Party of Virginia, and consequently you're seeing more conservatism coming out. Of course, some people would argue, well, we just got Terry McAuliffe as our governor in Virginia, so maybe that, but I don't say the two go, one's a consequence of the other. But the Tea Party's not going anywhere. And I think we make a big mistake as conservatives or within this party mechanism. I know we're not party here, but Republicans make a big mistake when they say, oh, let's just get rid of that pesky little abortion plank and let's get rid of those uncomfortable issues. Well, if you do that, Republicans are going to lose a lot of what little Black support they have and Hispanic support they have, and they're going to lose social conservatives, and they're not going to have much of a party if they do that. So I think they better think long and hard about taking advice on how they build their party from the mainstream media. I think that would be a huge mistake.
Ma'am, thank you.
Thank you. Second to the last question.
Hello, my name is Blake Johnson. I am a freshman student at College of the Ozarks, and my question to you is, how do you, as much as I love Bill O'Reilly, sometimes he says things that I don't necessarily agree with, but how do you get on his show every week and you hear the same basic big government progressive argument, whether it's from Bill or somebody else? How do you constantly go back and do it? Because it's so easily refuted, and it is refuted all the time, but they just keep repeating it. How do you keep going back and doing that? How do you find the encouragement to keep your mind from exploding?
I come here, literally. I mean, last night I thought, what am I doing? What am I doing? Because he said, I think I said this to you, talking about haters, and he said, okay, the hate comes equally from both sides. Like, well, no, it doesn't. Actually, it does not. You know, one side challenges, our side, frankly, challenges the ideas and the facts, because we have facts on our side. We have history on our side. The other side, of course, I didn't get to say this because I get interrupted the minute I start talking. But the other side comes at it with, you're racist, sexist, homophobic, you hate immigrants, you hate Muslims, everything. You hate. But if you listen to them, do they come up with sound rationale? I mean, on this Hobby Lobby thing, their argument, their sole argument is, conservatives want to deny contraception. Okay, that's not true. And it's not based in fact, and it's based on vilifying those people who hold that belief. So that's not an argument. That's a lie. And that is, to me, hate-filled. The vitriol coming that I talked to you guys about earlier is coming primarily, I mean, they're haters everywhere. But they're primarily the hate-filled rhetoric and the name-calling and the demonizing is coming squarely from the left. And we've got to call it on that. And so the reason I keep going back is because they haven't understood me yet. I haven't convinced them yet. And we just have to keep going back and back and back until we convince enough people that we're right and they don't have any arguments at all, until we achieve a majority and until of the population, really, because we're not even winning there. But until we start convincing people and winning them to our side, hey, let's win women to our side. Our message is so empowering to women. We've got to win them to our side. And we have to keep going back again and again and again, despite all the frustration and the angst that is caused when you argue with people who seem bullheaded. Not Bill O'Reilly, of course, I'd never say that about him. But people who are bullheaded, you have to keep going back. People who call you names, you're winning when they start calling you names. So keep going back. Wear it as a badge of honor.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Hello, my name's Ben from the Young Britons Foundation.
Great.
You have an extremely active social media presence. And for people our age, that's one of the most important ways that we can get our message out there. And yet, at the last presidential campaign, for every 28 tweets Obama put out, Romney put one out.
Yeah.
Are you optimistic about the penny finally dropping? I think with the Republican campaign, as to the importance of social media and what role we can play in pushing that.
Right. No, I'm not optimistic. That's an excellent point. You know, the thing that baffles me is how sometimes we conservatives, not we, but some conservatives, more establishment types, have trouble learning lessons. and implementing those lessons. I read Katie Pavlich's book, which you got to read, by the way, and it's fabulous. But I was struck by her interview with Mitt Romney. You mentioned him. But it revealed to me sort of the thinking of the establishment. And he said, it was about the war on women. She said, well, how could you have handled it differently? And he pretty much said, you know, there were just a lot of lies that were going on out there, and I don't think a lot of people really believed it. I don't think women really believed it. Okay, he lost single women by 36 points. They believed it. They totally believed it, and yet a lot of conservatives say, oh, that's a stupid argument. Nobody's falling for it. Oh, yeah, they are. And they're falling for it on social media. That's where it's being put out there in these short little sound bites. Republicans want to take your contraception away. Conservatives want to take women back to the Stone Ages. Conservatives hate these poor little babies who are stuck in this humanitarian crisis at the border. They don't care if they go back to a life of squalor and death and devastation. All that stuff is being put out there, and my concern is that there's silence on our side. The silence comes from fear, but it also comes from a lack of innovation and an understanding of technology. I think we get past that by you young people continuing to be innovative and blasting through the hold that consultants really have on the party and a lot of the conservative movement. They just have trouble with the notion that you guys are really bright and innovative and your ideas work. I don't know what it is, but they do. And that's what we need. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
I just want to say I am beyond thrilled to be here with you guys. I hope that you will take these lessons back to your campus. Look, we need to fire up freedom when you guys go back to your campus. You can't go back and just sit there in your classrooms and not do anything. I hope you get that, that they are systematically attacking what we believe in. And if young people are convinced that we are really as evil and hateful as they are painting you and me to be, they win. They don't just win the next election, but they win down the road, and we will become a socialist nation. And so it is up to each one of us. You know, you think, I'm this little individual, I can't do anything. Look around. We are a powerful force. The people in this room, and there are people like you all across the country, there are people like you on your campus. You guys have to find them, recruit them, and fire them up. You can do it. You have the training, you have the experience, and you have YAF behind you. They will give you any help, any support that you need, because they are committed to the very depths of their soul. These individuals, Pat and the rest of them, they believe in helping you fire up freedom on your campus. So go back there, please, and be these incredibly courageous leaders. And I can't wait to hear about all the great things you accomplish on campus this year. Thank you all so much.